I'll talk about the MASS project. That's about the massive solar system exploration. This is the outline of the presentation. I'm going to start with a brief introduction and motivation behind MASS, and also I'm going to illustrate to you how the team is composed. Then I'm going to give you some updates over the different work packages we have been working on. And finally, some future work remarks and also open question we still have and we are looking for to investigate. And to conclude, there will be a Q&A session. So this is the team structure and composition. It's made by three engineers and two mathematicians. It's not the beginning of a joke. It's just the idea of Stardust to have mathematicians and engineers working together. From the left to the right, you can see Edoardo Legnario, Maurizio Misquero, Mattia Pugliatti, Stefano Casini, and Christian Greco. What is MASS? The simplest way to introduce MASS to you is basically to refer to the Grand Tour, but done with asteroids. So instead of having flybys with the outer planets of the solar system, we want to propose an architecture that does flyby with a large population of asteroids. So MASS, in a nutshell, is an architecture that enables multiple flybys and rendezvous with near-Earth objects and eventually also interstellar objects. The purpose of why we want to do that is basically to characterize the composition, shape, and mass of a large population of small bodies, so a large sample of asteroid and comet. We want to do that with a standardized architecture that is based on CubeSat and an extensive usage of autonomous operations in order to achieve a truly massive exploration of the solar system. So it's important to remember previous missions, future missions, and also similar concepts that are related to MASS. Indeed, one of the first work packages we have been working on was related to basically a literature survey of the existing missions that were based on flybys with asteroids. And we have seen some of them also in the previous presentation from previous days during this event. So for example, NEOSHARE was presented yesterday by the Milo Institute and was a cluster of CubeSats that share the same launcher and with the aim to explore different near-Earth objects. Comet Interceptor was also named in a presentation a few days ago, basically a spacecraft parked in a orbit around the Sun-Earth L2 point, waiting for a flyby opportunity with a newly dynamically formed comet. Then there are also other missions such as Margo and Hera that involved 12-unit CubeSat to rendezvous with small-sized, rapidly spinning asteroids, or a couple of 6-unit CubeSat for enhanced scientific observation of the Deimos system. We have heard yesterday about Lucy and Janus, these two missions in which Lockheed Martin was involved, that flyby with Trojan asteroids or flyby with the binary system. And more, there is also the NEA Scout mission. It's a 6-unit concept with solar sail propulsion to fly by an asteroid that will be deployed from the maiden flight of the SLS, and NEARCUBE, 3-unit CubeSat to fly by a near-Earth object within 150 days. So there is a huge piece of work and studies involved into these flybys with CubeSat around asteroids. It's like a renaissance of this type of missions for space exploration. So we wanted to provide you just a clear picture of the panorama of what it exists and what we want to do differently, how we are located on the map with respect to these studies. In our project working group, basically, given a list of suitable trajectories towards N targets, we basically focused most of the design on a robust autonomous GNC system and on a detailed proximity analysis. The concept is to have a mothercraft parked around an orbit in a orbit around the Sun-Earth L2 point, containing in the order of tens of CubeSat, different CubeSat with different form factors. of, for example, 3U, 6U, or 12U, depending on whether they are going to fly by, whether or a rendezvous, or depending also on the scientific instruments that are going to be positioned within the CubeSat and so forth and so on. This is nice because it means we can basically complement the activity of the previous mission I've shown you before, in the sense that in the same mothercraft, you could have CubeSat from public institutions next to CubeSat from private industries or space agency, one next to each other, just waiting for their launching window, waiting for their launching opportunity. And within MASS, we want to provide a sketch of this architecture and also on how these CubeSats should be designed from the GNC perspective, for example, to perform these flybys. A bonus objective of MASS is to launch a CubeSat to fly by with an interstellar object. So these are very interesting objects, but as it was said in a presentation yesterday, it's very difficult to have a mission directly towards them because the moment you discover them, it's too late to set up an entire mission from zero. So we think that by having a CubeSat parked in orbit, ready to be deployed for this purpose, it could be a bonus scientific objective of this architecture to be able to deploy a flyby probe very quickly towards these interesting objects. So let's now go into the work we have done so far. I have to say this is still an ongoing work because this presentation sums up the work done in the last 2.5-3 months. So a lot of questions are still open, a lot of trade-offs are still open, and we are working on them, and we will be working on them in the coming months. Let's start with the interplanetary trajectory. We have Christian Greco working on it. The approach we have selected is basically a sequential approach. We start with the definition of database of targets with the list of our potential near-Earth objects that we could fly by or rendezvous with. And the strong point here is that we don't take one single database, we just merge different databases together, different relevant databases together. And also that we have the possibility to insert whatever object we want to fly by or rendezvous with no problem. Then we look at the orbital elements and other key parameter and characteristics, such as the ephemeris, uncertainties, and so on. And we basically prune our search space to the most interesting and suitable targets for our architecture. After this step, we perform a low fidelity global search. Basically, we look over the departure and arrival times, and we perform a grid search, low fidelity, with a grid search, low fidelity shaping methods, we try to understand what are the key parameters of the trajectories to reach these small bodies. So for example, it's important to have a quick estimation of the delta V involved, how the control profile would look like, and some other key parameters for the flyby, for example. And this is still it's an ongoing work. We were looking both for high thrust and low thrust options because, as I'm going to show you later, this will be a choice that is important in the close proximity of the asteroid during the flyby, for example. Then the third and last step is the high fidelity optimization. What we do is basically the best targets that came out from the previous step are taken, and we perform a high fidelity trajectory optimization in a full ephemeris dynamical model. And we plan to use a nonlinear programming solver in MATLAB so that we can basically rerun these analyses whenever we want to perform a search with slightly different parameters and so on. Then for the CubeSat design, and this is the work Stefan Casini is performing, we have a preliminary configuration for the 3-unit CubeSat. Stefan already talked about this in his presentation yesterday, and you can see some reference if you are interested in the details of it. Basically, the design is based on a fully commercial off-the-shelf component that is capable to deliver up to 400 meters per second in terms of delta V budget. And it's doing that by using a monopropellant chemical thruster. For what concern the payload, we rely on optical and infrared thermal imaging payloads. And most importantly, the design has been specifically tailored to allow for autonomous GNC capability. For what concerns transmission and, sorry, communication, we are using an X-band transmitter and antenna for downlink. And the total mass of the CubeSat is will be less than 4 kilograms. You can see the details in, either in the paper or in this table. So another important thing is the interplanetary cruise autonomous navigation. Basically, the idea is to have the CubeSat operating autonomously, navigating autonomously during the cruise, and doing that with the, by the usage of visible planets line of sight navigation. So we employ star trackers to track these planets and to perform celestial navigation. And from some preliminary analysis, it seems that 100 kilometer error in position and 0.001 kilometer per second error in velocity with a 3 sigma accuracy is reachable. We just want to say that basically these analyses will be performed tailored for each specific trajectory that will come out from the optimization tool. The plot you see on the right basically show you the amount of days before the flyby, before reaching the closest approach, that you need to be able to detect the asteroid, in this case, Eros, as a function of the phase angle and the distance from the sun. As you can see, this change from 3 to 9 days, and is basically depending on these parameters. This is just to say that the flyby per se will be a very fast event in which a lot of scientific observation and navigation and control tasks will be allocated in a very, very short period of time during the mission. Concerning the flyby, and this is part of the work I am doing, let's say this, that you basically have two options in the flyby menu, that's what we call it. That is the flyby of the past and the flyby of the future. The flyby of the past, that is the one on the top left, is a flyby you do with a very small field of view in terms of camera and optical instruments at a very large distance. So what happens is that you have a smaller scientific return, but you have a very slow rotation to keep track of the asteroid during the flyby. This means low pointing requirements and stability requirements, and is a simple maneuver to perform even as a bonus scientific objective when you are a big spacecraft, a big mission going somewhere else, just passing by an asteroid. Do this maneuver is kind of simple to do. The flyby of the future, on the other hand, is, this is the direction in which MASS would like to go, is on the bottom right part. We would like to use bigger field of view instruments, so keeping the same resolution from commercial off-the-shelf components. That will have a big impact from uncertainties in the flyby parameters, but will have a bigger scientific return because this enables the possibility to use those instruments that need to be very close to the asteroids to provide the meaningful results. So we would have a new proximity observation, for example, from LIDAR, magnetometers, or to study the interior composition, or also a better understanding of the gravity field of the asteroid and also its mass, for example. The drawback of this approach is a fast rotation that will put you in a strict with strict pointing requirements and stability. And that's what we are trying to challenge within this framework. For the flyby itself, we are developing what we call a flyby optical simulator. That basically means we use Blender for the rendering of different small body objects. We plug in a flyby trajectory or its parameters, and we basically render what the spacecraft would look at if we would have doing if it is doing the flyby. We plan to use these for objects that are bigger than a certain threshold in terms of pixel, and before this we will be using representative models. Any shape can be plugged into this this simulator, and any trajectory, any flyby can be tested. the purpose of having these is at the end, this will be embedded in a closed loop GNC subsystem, and this will make us be capable to test how robust the navigation and the overall GNC subsystem is with respect to different flyby conditions, different bodies, different shapes, and so on and so forth. One important thing to do before getting to the closest approach distance with respect to the flyby is to estimate what are the parameters of the flyby trajectory we are flying. So we believe one possible approach that would be helpful is the one illustrated here in the top left, that's basically having a camera inertially pointing the asteroid at the beginning. And then by studying its motion, by studying basically the variation of the phase angle with respect to the asteroid, what we try to attempt is to estimate what kind of flyby are we flying to, what kind, and most importantly, what is the closest approach distance of the flyby we are following with our path. In case this closest approach distance doesn't match our desired distance, we basically perform correction maneuvers to change these and to put ourselves in the nominal flyby solution. Another task we are doing, this is at a very preliminary stage, is we want to introduce noise into those images to be as representative as possible of a realistic situation. So far, we have just introduced cosmic ray events, some general blurring of the asteroid, and some random Gaussian noise mixture into the images. Another thing you can do during the flyby, during the closest approach, is to use the artificial intelligence algorithm to enhance the scientific return, but also to aid in the navigation part. One example of this is, for example, the use of convolutional neural network for the shape classification of the body you are flybying with. And this is illustrated in a precedent work, and you can find the reference there if you are interested. Or, for example, to have some surface morphological segmentation of the asteroid at closest approach that enhance some pinpoint scientific observation in the last leg of the flyby after the closest approach. So that basically once you are online on board, you can study in depth what are the characteristics of the surface and then focus your scientific observation in the final part of the flyby on them. Another part that could be do with the artificial intelligence techniques is the flyby parameters estimation I just showed you before. So what we plan to do is to augment the traditional image processing approach that are basically relying on a robust center of brightness algorithm with something a little bit more sophisticated that we show it will be robust, or we hope it will be robust to the different uncertainties and the shapes and flyby parameters of our simulation. Another area that is being focused by our mathematicians, Eduardo Legnaro and Mauricio Misquero, is, for example, in the shape modeling part. So, for example, we know that for optical from optical light course, we can get the shape and the spin of the body. But because the albedo is unknown, basically these shape and spin per se are not tight and they are not scaled. So they will provide us some scale-free models. So one possible solution that will also help us in other areas is the use of thermal infrared data. With this, we can scale the shape models and derive thermophysical and properties of the surface of the flyby target. And I just want to add that this can be useful also for the full shape reconstruction of the body, because it will allow us to see also the shadow part of the object at the beginning and at the end of the flyby that otherwise will not be mapped into a shape model. And also that it can be used for the same reason for navigation purposes instead of the optical images.
Sorry, Mattia, you still have 5 minutes plus five for questions.
Perfect, thanks. And something that just developed from this is the 3D shape reconstruction. So we have done some preliminary analysis into this on how to onboard reconstruct the shape from a set of images during the flyby or slightly before the closest approach distance. And finally, to conclude, and this is where Maurice Miskero work is focused on, is on dynamical environment. This could be applicable either for a very low velocity flyby with an asteroid or for the case of the rendezvous. Basically, the usage of the investigation upon the dynamical environment around small bodies. Different models were analyzed and taken into consideration. The idea is that it would be enough to use an expansion of ellipsoidal potential up to order 2 for the case we are considering. Moreover, it would be interesting to focus some time for investigating the capability of frozen orbits around asteroids and comets, around small bodies, and especially to investigate the different perturbations that act into these frozen orbits, mainly due to resonance and due to other gravitational phenomena. So this is to conclude future work. As I said before, this is an ongoing work we are doing. Future works that we will be focusing in the coming months are on the methods to determine the mass without the need for orbit determination techniques. And we have heard something interesting a couple of days ago about techniques that use, for example, the Yarkovsky effect. This is still an open question to us, how you could determine the mass, not only from the shape and some loose estimation on the density, on the surface density. We are looking for a way to determine the mass that fit in our framework. So if you have any idea, you are welcome to contact us. Then future work will be focused also on navigation strategy simulation, assessment of high-low thrust maneuvers during approach, because this will be relevant in terms of timing during the flyby to adjust the maneuver timely before we reach the closest approach, to perform the first terminal GNC closed-loop simulations, and to test the optimization tool and change the selection criteria to see how the architecture evolves, basically. This is it. I thank you very much for your attention. If you have any questions, please do them. We are here to answer. And we also put our email in case you want to contact us. Thank you very much.